never gone birding before, but who really, I can kind of see their eyes open before me as I'm showing them bird species around them that they had never thought to, you know, look at before or didn't know what they were. And so I think that college in particular can be a really formative space for getting more students into activities around the natural world, and through that, motivating them to care about conservation and sustainability. So in high school, I got involved with a group called Lights Out Baltimore that looks at bird window collisions in Baltimore, where I was growing up. That was the group that first taught me about the issue of bird window collisions. Windows kill about a billion birds a year, and Princeton's campus is not exempt from that. There are a couple of buildings on campus that are primarily glass that pose severe threats to birds. One of the deadliest buildings we found is the garden.
Good morning and welcome to the Princeton University Chapel on this third Sunday after Easter. We are delighted that you are in worship with us, whether you're in our chapel or joining us via live stream. This is the Sunday following last night's spring Milbank concert. Our university choir is usually full, but after a season of singing through Easter, now we're in Eastertide, and last night they had a delightful concert. Our choir is taking a break this Sunday, and we are thankful to have our soloist, Sarah, a junior here at Princeton University, leading us in music today. On the back of your bulletins, you will find what's happening in the life of the chapel over the next week and coming weeks. This afternoon at 1:30 is the Hallelujah Worship Service that will happen over in Murray Dodge Hall. Thursday here in this space is our afternoon concert series. We're back here again next Sunday, but mark your calendars for May 1st. Can you believe it's almost May 1st? Ruth Cunningham will be here on Sound Journey. And if you're interested in a tour of this space and learning more about the history of the chapel, sign up for the next tour of the guided chapel tour. My friends, we come to worship. Sometimes we feel like it, sometimes we do not. But when we show up in this space together as community, Spirit meets us. May we rise on our feet and our hearts and join in spirit and prayer as we sing our opening hymn, hymn number 253.
Thank you.
give thanks unto the Lord, for God is good, for God's mercy endures forever. Friends, today we reside in the gift of God's new mercy. We reside in the knowledge that there's nothing that we've done to deserve it, but simply because God loves us, we've been given another day to commune with our community and our God. Let us dwell in the comfort of that renewed mercy as we prepare to approach God in prayer. Let us pray. Dear most gracious and loving God, God, we thank you. We thank you that your spirit already rests in this place. God, open our hearts and minds this morning and remove any distractions that impede us from hearing from you. It is in the mighty name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. You may be seated. A reading from Acts. When Peter saw it, he addressed the people, "You Israelites, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we had made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors has glorified God's servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the holy and righteous one and asked to have a murderer given to you, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses, and by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what God had foretold through all the prophets, that the Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out." Here ends the reading.
Thank you. A reading from the Gospel of Luke. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" And they gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." This is the end of the reading.
Please join me in a spirit of prayer. Our gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of every one of our hearts be ever acceptable to you, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. The friends are huddled together. They are in a room with a bolted shut door, bolted windows. It is very dim. No candles are lit. They try not to make a sound in the darkness. They are terrified. They were on the wrong side, the losing side of history, apparently. They were the closest associates of the leader of an amazing new movement, and they'd staked everything in their lives to do that. He was tortured and executed like a common criminal. Everything about what they'd stood for with him was mocked and crushed. The empire gets its last laugh again, and it gets its revenge. Everyone wants to find these friends and kill them too. And if that's not enough to cause terror, there is a report from friends in Emmaus that they actually saw Jesus alive. Crazy. Or not crazy, they really believe it. They say it was indisputably him. He told them things only he could know. He opened the scriptures to them in ways that only he could. They have no doubt that they were in his presence. And then he vanished, just poof, leaving them with hearts on fire. They're not afraid anymore. They are proclaiming what they believe with a passion that will not stop, and so publicly. But the hopes and the curiosity of the friends in this darkened room are eclipsed by their fear. They are going to need their own proof. So Jesus comes to them. While the friends are talking about it, he just appears. He says, "Peace be with you." And they are terrified. Those words were a common greeting in that place and time. Even today, they are. You see a friend or stranger in different parts of the world, and you say shalom or aloha. But in Jesus' usage, and particularly in Luke's gospel, the word peace also connotes salvation. The friends are so agitated, not simply because someone magically appeared in their hideaway and said, "Hi," but because he said, peace. They are terrified because this might be Jesus. So patiently does he help them through their terror. First, he helps them accept that he is not a ghost. He shows them his feet and hands, and they have real bones in them. These are the most visibly bony parts of our bodies, and folks then were very sure that ghosts don't have bones. He shows them that his feet touch the floor, and ghosts float, of course. And the ultimate test, they bring him real food, and he eats it, because ghosts can't eat. Now that they are better able to listen to him, first he stills their fears, and then he opens their minds. We could use both of those things too, couldn't we? I know I could. The stilling of my fears and the opening of my mind. We, like the first friends of Jesus, have just come through the crucifixion and resurrection. We are now Easter people, but really critical things hold us back from being Christ's witnesses to this new reality of the universe. It is about our fears and about our ignorance and our unbelief. So let us understand Christ to be joining us today, as we need him to do. He met those disciples exactly where they were, physically, emotionally, spiritually. He offers us the very same presence. What do we fear? And what can Jesus say to us about those fears? There are our very human fears first. We fear death. We learned in Sunday school that after death comes a space of total blessing, but where's the proof? And we don't want to let go of this brief, brief life we have on earth. We tell ourselves to appreciate every second of every day, but we lose so much of our conscious moments to worry, to being pissed off, to being dissatisfied, to being afraid. We worry that our lives may end so suddenly, over. For myself, I worry less about my own death than that of getting a phone call or a knock that begins, "There's been an accident," and I lose someone I love with all my heart. We have other fears of vulnerability to financial challenges or to violence, vulnerability to rejection, vulnerability to failures on many levels, and we live compromised lives to try to stay safe from it all. We do not risk. Our fear overcomes our hope and our joy. We have spiritual fears, too. Will I look like an idiot to the world around me if I boldly proclaim my belief in this crazy story of resurrection? Will I be considered anti-intellectual? In an academic setting such as Princeton, there are followers of many faiths who practice their beliefs quietly. Another fear that people share with me is, what if I make real changes to my life because of my faith? What if I let it redirect everything I thought I was going to do? What if it reorients everything I have valued? Am I ready to get rid of most of my possessions? And do I have the guts to buck every social convention around me? I have not forgotten a student who graduated a few years ago, quite active in the Office of Religious Life, who I always saw wearing the same brown sweater. I applied my own lens to his life, and I decided that it was simply his favorite, or maybe he had financial challenges that restricted his ability to purchase clothing. Then I learned that he was from a quite privileged background, but that as an item of faith, in his case, Buddhism, he had decided to give away anything he didn't really need. He could only wear one sweater at a time, so he had one. He still lives this way today, with as much simplicity as possible and with as few things as possible, only what he needs. I know that many of us avoid considering options like this for ourselves because we fear that we might actually make deep changes to the way we live. There is a kind of safety in sticking with the majority of people in the choices that we make and to stockpiling assets. Jesus tells his friends in every age, fear not. Painful things will happen. That is unavoidable when living in this world. Keep living the life that truly is life. Whatever happens, he says, I am and I'm holding you. Jesus never told us that life would be easy, only that we are blessed to be always in the unending arms of God's love, no matter what becomes or befalls us. Our faith doesn't save us from suffering, but it reminds us of suffering's context. In this world, that we are the inheritors of the gospel of salvation and putting it into practice in our humble lives every day. And in the next life, that we live in light perpetual, immersed in a pool of holy love that defies all our human imagination. The other thing that Jesus does for his shattered, hiding friends is to open their minds. They and we are human, so yes, we live in ignorance and unbelief. We think, if Jesus showed up right here and now and revealed the truth of the scriptures to me, I would get over my ignorance and unbelief really fast. And that is true. What we do have, though, are the scriptures themselves and the good teachers who have gone before us. For each of us is the responsibility to work on whatever actually limits our minds, be it narcissism, fear, avoidance, smallness of imagination, doubt, self-doubt, and the lack of self-esteem, so many things. I think smallness of imagination is my greatest obstacle. I don't really get the enormity of salvation, the profundity of God's love, the depths of holiness in every moment. This last week, I had the privilege of being at the bedside of a dying person and was reminded that so many of us, as we approach the end of this life, finally start to really get it. I want my mind open now, not then. As one pastor has put it, the power of the resurrection is the power to plant the seeds of transformation. A mind transformed, a life transformed, a death transformed eventually. I want all these things, but if I'm being honest, I fear them too. So many things to consider from Jesus' teachings for us today. How do we let the good news we've heard most or all of our lives unlock our minds so we might truly live? How do we recognize the locked doors we are living behind? Many of them may appear to us to be the blessings of structure and security and safety in the form of certainties and plans. Locked doors, as the early friends of Jesus found out, don't bring us peace or security. They actually exacerbate our fears. They create an echo chamber for them and amplify them. Peace and security may be, I don't know, the same thing in terms of international relations. Peace and security are not the same thing in terms of daily life, and certainly not the life of faith. Jesus showed up and he said, peace. It starts with peace. The foundation is peace. We hunger for peace, the peace that passes all understanding, the peace that persists no matter what hard things happen in our lives and in our deaths, the peace that connotes salvation. Perhaps the key to letting our faith vanquish our fears and ignorance is, in all its simplicity, to center our hearts on that peace, which is our salvation. Amen.
seated. Friends, now is the time in our service where we come together as a community to share in our joys and sorrows and victories and challenges and lift them up in community to our God. If there is a prayer or a petition or something that you'd like to share on your heart and mind, just raise your hand and Deja will come over to you with the microphone.
Our deepest gratitude to our families gathered today to celebrate our engagement.
As we listen to you over again, Jesus, when you give us peace, let us teach us how to open our heart and mind and our eyes, not to accept you as just as doctrine, but as you, as the Word yourself.
Prayer for our son Raymond as he begins his trek across half the world, and wish him all the luck and all other things in his heart and mind as he begins and keeps his things going.
Pray for my daughter and son-in-law and our grandson, Barrett, and Landon, and we look forward to seeing our son who lives out in Portland, Oregon, and he will be here on the sometime around the 20th of June.
Thank you, Lord, for your amazing message of peace shared this morning. Please bless us with your peace. And I'd like to share a little bit from your prophet Isaiah, who foretold the message we heard from 55. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And you who have no money, come. Buy and eat, yes, come, buy wine and milk, without money and without price. Why do you spend money for what is not bread, and your wages for what does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good, and let your soul delight itself in abundance. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear, and your soul shall live. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out with joy and be led out with peace. The mountains and the hills shall bring forth into singing before you, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Please continue to bless us with your peace, O Lord. May we share it. May we be light and love with those with whom you have blessed to be in our path.
I ask for prayers for discernment for myself and for anybody else here who is discerning their call to ministry.
My friends, please pray with me. Let's begin by lifting up the prayers of this community. Dear God, we start with a prayer of thanksgiving and a prayer for your continued blessing and presence as we celebrate the engagement of our very dear friends in this Princeton community. We pray that you might guide them, continue to show them your light, and continue to form their union in a way that's ultimately glorifying to you. We pray that you help this community to support them and be with them every step of their journey. Dear God, we pray that you might help us to listen. This world is so busy. Help us to take moments to seek you, to seek what you might be speaking to us, and to seek peace. We pray for peace in this world in all of the ways that are oh so troubled. Each of us could list off an exhaustive list of all of the ways in all of the areas of life, in our community, near and far, that need desperately a dousing of your peace. And we pray for that peace, and that peace might come. And we pray that you help us to be agents of your peace. We pray for traveling mercies. We give thanks for the joys of being able to traverse this beautiful planet. We thank you for the gift of family, both biological and chosen. And we pray for safe travels for our family members as they visit us and as they return to their homes. God, we pray that, as is said in the prophet Isaiah, that we might come to you, we might come before you, that we might seek in all ways, to seek in your word, to seek in your beloved community, and to seek to do that which you are asking of us. Dear God, we pray for discernment in all areas of life. Dear God, we know that you have a vocational call on each and every one of our lives, and we pray that you might continue to reveal to us how you might be calling us. In this Princeton University community, we pray for academics. We pray for guidance and wisdom in enduring academic pressures. Lord God, we celebrate our academic achievements and our breakthroughs, especially those that will move on from here with us and change our world. Lord God, we pray for mental and physical health. We pray for healing for all of those that are struggling with challenges of physical health, mental health, and neurodivergence. Lord God, we pray for strength and for recovery for those that are dealing with illness and disability, and resources and support for our total wellness. God, we know that you know that it's a tough time. And we pray for provision, especially for students and families struggling with school fees, book costs, and living expenses. And we pray for their families and those who are facing economic hardship. We pray that in this tense and difficult moment for our world, that you help us to respect and understand and appreciate the diversity that is manifest among us. We pray that you help us to promote inclusivity and combat discrimination in our midst. We pray, Lord God, that you enlighten us to opportunities for our growth, development, and self-discovery through you. We pray for encouragement from above and for encouragement within our community for all of those of us who are exploring our spiritual lives. We pray that you strengthen our friendships and professional relationships. We pray for unity and collaboration within our university community and within our world. Lord God, especially on a moment like this, when the headlines keep seeming to get worse and worse, we pray for peace, for security, and resolution in conflict areas all around the world, especially in the Middle East. We pray for a swift end to injustice and oppression every way and all of the ways that it exists. We pray for awareness and action in our environmental catastrophes and climate change. Lord, please be with us in our leadership and decision-making capacities. Help us to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with you. And God, we pray for guidance. Guidance in this moment when we leave this space and always, especially for graduating students as they're making career choices and decisions about next steps. Lord, we end this prayer in a prayer of thanks. Thanks for the hope and the blessings that you have granted to us and that are with us now and always. We pray for all of those facing uncertain times, and we pray that we might live into how you are calling us so that we can truly live. God of love and mercy, hear our prayer. My friends, please join me in the Lord's Prayer as is printed in our bulletins. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. My friends, please remember the peace of Christ is with you now and always. May God's peace always be with you. Please rise and show one another a sign of peace.
Friends, every time we gather here on Sundays, we take a free will offering, an expression of our gratitude to God for all that we have been given. We are blessed at the chapel not to need that money ourselves. We give it all away, every penny. As you'll see in your bulletin today, the organization that will receive that money is the United Way of Greater Mercer County. The money will stay local to be given out by the United Way to a variety of organizations right here in our area, our county, serving the most vulnerable people here. Please, won't you be as generous as you are able?
Please join me in the prayer for Princeton printed in our bulletins. O eternal God, the source of life and light for all peoples, we pray you would endow this university with your grace and wisdom. Give inspiration and understanding to those who teach and to those who learn. Grant vision to its trustees and administrators, to all who work here, and to all who bear her name. Give your guiding spirit of sacrificial courage and loving service. Amen.
Now may the peace which passes all understanding guide our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God our Creator, Christ our Redeemer, the Holy Spirit our Sustainer, this beautiful afternoon and even forevermore. Amen.